The great sci-fi art of the mid-20th century teased a vision of the future with one distinct element in common: a life for humans in outer space. Whether vacationing on an exotic new planet or commuting to the moon for business, space travel seemed like it was just around the corner. Yet here we are, a half century later, and only about 500 human beings have ever left the bounds of Earth's atmosphere. But thanks to a set of ambitious private companies betting on the promise of space tourism, that long-awaited future could be here sooner than we think. For most of the history of spaceflight, governments have been the prime force behind nearly every aspect, from planning to funding to crew selection. But as early as the 1980s, proposals for commercial space tourism began to emerge, along with innovative solutions for getting people there, such as the wild concept of sticking a 74-person passenger cabin in the cargo bay of a NASA space shuttle. Although various non-astronauts have been selected for missions over the years, true space tourism didn't happen until 2001, when an entrepreneur named Denis Tito coughed up an estimated $20 million to hitch a ride with the Russian Federal Space Agency for a week-long vacation aboard the International Space Station. 20 years later, we're seeing a new contender in this final frontier of tourism: private companies.
It's becoming a private enterprise situation, still very high risk with a high reward, potential reward. But, you know, government is really out of the business of flying people now, and it's really going to be companies like Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos and Richard Branson that do that heavy lifting. Commercial space tourism is usually about taking the non-astronaut, the private citizen, into an orbital or suborbital flight. So you get a short amount of microgravity experience and you can float and take some photos. And then you come back. This was something that technology had gotten to a point where the private sector was going to make a business out of this. There are multiple companies that want to get to the place where they fly people into space.
The first of these is Blue Origin, founded in 2000 by Jeff Bezos. Using the autonomous rocket system New Shepard, a tribute to the first American in space, Blue Origin plans to launch up to 6 passengers at a time, offering a rarefied treat of 62-mile-high views and a momentary experience of weightlessness. Booking officially kicked off in May 2021, with the very first seat to be auctioned off for charity. Meanwhile, Richard Branson's Virgin Galactic has also been pursuing a viable form of suborbital tourism, aiming for a launch in 2022 once Sir Richard himself has taken a flight.
I'm hoping to be able to go to space. I'd love to be able to coincide it with the moon landing and go to space. So I've got the whip on the team and we'll see how we go.
The company claims to have lined up over 600 seat reservations so far, including Justin Bieber and Leonardo DiCaprio. Virgin has projected that the final cost of the ticket will be at least $250,000, or roughly $50,000 for each of the 5 minutes or so of weightlessness that you'll get to experience. Although costly, both companies' offerings aim to make suborbital flight a regular form of adventure travel, eventually driving down costs at scale to expand the customer base beyond the orbit of celebrities and billionaires. The third major contender is Elon Musk's SpaceX, which has set its sights even higher on orbital flights, which are
a whole nother level of complexity and energy and danger. When you go suborbital, if you're just going to go up above the von Karman line, which is 100 kilometers or about 62 miles, you only need to get up to maybe 5,000 miles an hour to get up there, and you go basically straight up and then straight back down. You don't have the reentry heating that you would see coming in from an orbital. So when you go orbital, I don't care if you're a baseball or a battleship, you've got to go 17,500 miles per hour, not just 5,000 miles an hour. The energies involved are much greater. By doing that, SpaceX has gone another level up, and that's what they're doing with the Inspiration 4.
Visit inspiration4.com for your chance to go to space.
Inspiration 4 is the first planned all-civilian mission into orbit, slated to launch in late 2021. The crew will bring their own set of diverse perspectives and backgrounds and experiences to test how a group of different people, namely people who aren't professional astronauts, could fare in space.
Until now, astronauts have had to be physically perfect, and this mission is changing that. And so I feel incredibly honored to be representing those who aren't physically perfect. At age 10, I was diagnosed with bone cancer, and I was treated at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. And I spent a year there undergoing intense chemo and also surgery that ultimately saved my leg. I now work at St. Jude as a PA, a physician assistant, and I work with leukemia and lymphoma patients. The kids we work with are so brave, and they are very excited to watch me go to space because this is showing them that, you know, they're capable of doing this as well.
Haley, along with three other crew members, will spend 3 days in space, orbiting the Earth every 90 minutes before landing back off the coast of Florida.
Well, when you think about access, the astronauts for the United States came from the test pilot side. And so women weren't allowed to be a part of that. We have somebody in their 20s, somebody in their 30s, somebody in their 40s, and somebody in their 50s. And so there can be access in all kinds of way, whether you're talking about age, whether you're talking about gender, whether you're talking about race and ethnicity and all of those things.
The first time, you know, people are going up into space and not sent there by a superpower like the United States or Russia or China, well, that's like really significant. And, you know, you've got to, you know, be very thoughtful about it. The whole game plan right now is to make space like really affordable and, you know, accessible for everybody so that you can have fishing buddies go into space someday. But the first is special. And so with that, we wanted to have, you know, a crew selection process that could make space available to everyday people.
Getting to space is only the first step for space tourism. The next challenge is what to do and where to stay when you get there. Axiom Space is planning to launch the first segment of a new commercial space station in 2024. Their $2 billion project, called Axe Station, will become the first free-flying private international space station. Or, to use a more consumer-friendly term, a space hotel. Axiom isn't the only company out to make your space stay a little more comfortable. Bigelow Aerospace has been building what they call expandable habitat technology, like their B330. An inflatable pod module that expands once in orbit.
There's even one attached to the International Space Station right now. They've been testing it. And you take it up and it's rather small, and then you inflate it, and it seems to be working very, very well. This is likely to be the first kind of tourist hotel that you're going to see up in space. First of all, it's easier to carry instead of this giant tin can with all of that. The inflatables are lighter. You can just blow them up and they get a nice big size for about, you know, less than half the weight probably.
But even as space missions become accessible to civilians,
the risks of going into space are incredibly high. And you could die 1,000 ways that we can think of and 1,000 other ways that we can't think of.
This is Michelle Hanlon. She's a space lawyer at the Mississippi School of Law focused on protecting humans in outer space.
Now, I'm not an attorney for any of the space tourists, so I haven't been privy to their private contracts. But I can tell you that the FAA requires certain waivers to be in those contracts. So, for example, the FAA says, well, we're not going to make you make your spacecraft to a certain safety level. We are going to make you spacecraft operator. Make sure that you inform your space tourists of all of the hazards that you know of. I imagine a very long waiver, all the ways you can die in space. And you have to understand that there's health risks, and you have to indemnify the U.S. government if you are launching from the United States. So those are things that we know a space tourist has to sign and has to waive. So now let's go back and think about our space flight participants. The FAA calls space tourists space flight participants. They don't call them astronauts. Why is that important? If you're not an astronaut, there's no obligation to rescue you if something goes wrong. It's a lot of money to set up a rescue launch. If it can even be done, it's something really important to think about, and that difference as we cross this threshold from having astronauts in space to having real people like me in space.
And when we are able to make it to space reliably enough, there's still a host of other legal and ethical issues to consider before space tourism can truly take off.
There are so many gaps in space law that we are going to have to put in a lot of sort of basement ideas. And so, for example, the Outer Space Treaty is a treaty that offers principles and guidelines for state activities, for the activities of national governments. It doesn't talk about private entities, doesn't talk about humans in space. So now if something goes wrong, so let's think about all the times hotels on Earth are sued, right? So slip and falls, you step on something in the bathroom, you sue the hotel, and it becomes a private lawsuit. because of the vagaries of international law, if something happens in space, well, boy, you can sue the state that launched your spacecraft. You can sue the company that brought you there. You can sue the hotel. You can sue the individual. You can sue every government related to that, because the way the Outer Space Treaty and the Outer Space Regime have set this up is that anything that happens in space first has to go through a diplomatic channel before you think about suing in a court of law. And so every single slip and fall in a space hotel is a diplomatic nightmare. And so we really need to figure that out before we start sending a lot of people there. You think about human rights in space. Here, we don't think about a human right to oxygen because it's kind of all around us and free. It's not in a space hotel. So what happens if something happens and the oxygen depletes? Who gets the oxygen first? And then, of course, let's not even think about the labor. How do you treat your labor in a space hotel where that person may be there for 2 or 3 years without coming back to Earth? So a lot of things to think about.
Space habitats are more likely in the near future to focus on research missions and be a home for experiments that can't happen as easily back on Earth.
Space hotels, I think they garner a lot of headlines and a lot of news, but at the same time, that's not the first thing that you're gonna see happen. They don't offer the compelling business case, I think, that you'll see from a place that wants to manufacture pharmaceuticals or a new type of crystal or some type of filament or fiber optic cables and other things that you can do in microgravity. The things that are actually, you know, a high value finished good, when you get that back to Earth and you sell it for a very, very huge profit margin, that's what's likely to happen in space, as opposed to having a real estate platform that you sell to a tourist. A space hotel is really interesting and it will probably happen, but it's not likely to be at the forefront of space commerce.
Even if space hotels are right around the corner, don't get too excited about booking a trip in one.
It's not a cheap ticket to ride to space, and it's gonna be, you know, millionaires and billionaires and that sort. But at the same time, you know, the point was made that in the early days of airline trips, that was also a completely unaffordable ticket for most people. Those people who flew were people of means, and over time it becomes affordable to the masses. And I think that's the goal for all the entrepreneurs in space as well, to get those costs down to a point where it's not $10 million or $5 million or $300,000 ride into suborbital space, when it becomes more like buying a first-class ticket to go to Europe from the United States. So that's the goal, and you know, the question is, can we get to that point?
Given the immense operating costs of getting to space, it may be years, if ever, until space tourism becomes a profitable venture for any of these companies. Virgin Galactic, the only publicly traded company of the three, has had a particularly rocky year, initially riding on the momentum of a SPAC deal, but more recently beset by launch delays and major funders, including Branson himself, selling large quantities of their stock in the company.
Space is really, really, really hard, and it's an absolute cliche, but it's one that happens to be very true. It's just really hard to do. That's also the reason that you've seen the delays that, you know, Virgin had talked about flying years and years ago. And it became such a crazy point that Richard Branson actually stopped talking about it when he was asked, because it was never going to be when he predicted. But it's not insurmountable. And, you know, investors have stepped up because this is something that is doable.
Despite the astronomical dangers and costs of getting to space, it may ultimately follow the course of other once fanciful modes of travel.
Wright brothers having, you know, what was by modern standards a very unimpressive first flight, you know, at Kitty Hawk. I mean, you know, you had like less than 20 years later, you had your first airborne ambulances being used to save lives. Fundamentally, the world is a more interesting place when people can go and dance among the stars and such.
The lure of space is innate. It's in our DNA. It's that exploration bug. We are an exploratory species, and we want to go out there and see what's out there.
That vision that I had in 1969 of seeing normal human beings travel into space, it's finally beginning to happen. When you get a bunch of people up there and they can all see it for themselves, that'll create even yet another revolution in how we treat our planet and the way we think about it.
So while 2001 came and went without quite looking like Stanley Kubrick's ultimate space fantasy, 2021 might finally be the year we're catching up.